Good.
Okay, let's try that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
I figured my cheetah print girls here will be a little bit more vibrant this morning. Do me a favor, please stand and worship with us this morning. It's Come As You Are. Appreciate it.
in seventh grade. I remember my first Wednesday night in the middle school room, where I was a little nervous, but staff notes and the students quickly made me feel right at home. As I grew older and entered the high school program, I really began to look forward to every Wednesday and every highlight of my week. I was proud to be heartbroken when we had to cancel due to weather or taking a break from holidays. I always looked forward to attending any event held because I knew I would be surrounded by like-minded people that had good intentions in life. I loved how the lessons provided me with time to reflect on my relationship with God when I didn't have enough time in my personal life to do so. The youth program here at Westminster truly changed my life and provided me the tools to have a relationship with God. The reason that I applied to become a youth ministry leader was to personally help ensure that the youth program I know and love continues to provide the same loving and accepting environment that helped shape me into who I am today. When I was a student at Westminster, I did not think about or realize how finances played a role in the youth group. As I transitioned to a volunteer role after I graduated, now being on staff, I realized that many of my great experiences would not have happened without the financial support of the congregation. Not only do staff salaries need to be paid, but that all reliable church van needs to be filled up with gas on our trips, the special games and events that we hold need to be funded, and our lock-ins, which really get the kids excited, do have a cost. And I know that just providing financial support may not seem like the most engaging way to help with our youth program, but it really can be. When I was a kid, I remember that any time I went out with my friends, whether it be to a movie, eating dinner, or going to an amusement park, my dad would always give me some cash so I didn't have to worry about missing out. Now, my dad didn't care about seeing the latest action movie that all the kids were talking about, and there was no chance he'd ever take a seat on a roller coaster. But he knew that I wanted those things, and he wanted me to be able to do those things. So you might not want to take a 4-hour road trip in that smelly church van, surrounded by Pringles dust and kids singing along to Party in the USA, but our students loved being out there for hours at a time. But for some reason, a part of building faith in middle school and high school students is giving shots to the string and having shaping rewards, which I am happy to participate in. And for those of you who have no interest in running around the church and screaming, we really do appreciate your financial support. Thank you.
Thanks, Stephen. Well, let's take a moment of prayer as we continue our worship today. Holy God, as Stephen pointed us to, we're grateful for the ministries of this church, for the time and the places and resources that are given to it so that we can have some time in our life to encounter you on a regular basis. So as we gather together in worship, can we take a moment and just name some of the things in our hearts and minds for which we are grateful about the ministries of Westminster. Maybe it's the worship. Maybe it's particular faces. Maybe it's some of the study groups. Maybe it's the mission activities that we do. Take a moment, name some of those events, programs, people who have been meaningful to you. Holy God, we are grateful for all the people who contribute to make Westminster what it is, but most of all, we're grateful for you, your presence, that you bless us. With your presence, by showing up and giving us guidance in our lives. Amen. I invite you to rise and bow your spirit if you'd like for another song.
Thank you. Hey, thank you for that so very much. An important question, ma'am. Are you a flutist or a flautist? Okay, all right. Yes, the answer is yes. Well, if you don't play the flute, that joke doesn't mean a lot to you. If you do, then it does. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark. Jesus is in the temple complex. Remember, the temple complex is about a 20-acre area on the top of a mountaintop, Mount Zion. It is walled in, and it includes huge sort of open spaces for gatherings. Probably some places, you know, where you can buy sacrificial items, that kind of thing. And then the temple itself. So where Jesus is not actually in the temple, not in the temple building, but it's on that the top of the mountain in that temple complex. And he is sitting near the box where you bring your offering. So we've got, fine, you want to hold up our offering box? Our offering basket back there? Yes, thank you. Jesus is sitting near the equivalent of that at this time. It says, he, Jesus, sat down opposite the treasury, the box, and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she out of her poverty has put in everything she had, all she had to live on. This is the word of the Lord for us this day. Thanks be to God. One of the most beloved pop stars of the 1980s was a woman named Cyndi Lauper. Cyndi Lauper, yes, I can see the eyes going, yes, Cyndi Lauper. C-Y-N-D-I was how she spelled her name. Today, you really only see her on television commercials for plaque psoriasis medicine. But in her day, Cyndi Lauper stood out in a number of ways. She especially had a tremendous fashion sense, practically personifying the leather and lace dichotomy of the 1980s, and her hair changed color with her mood ring. You know, mini skirts, lace gloves, and hair that changed color by the week were all part of the Cyndi Lauper look. So all of you who dye your hair red or blue, depending on whatever, you owe it to Cyndi Lauper. She made that acceptable. So trust me when I say, whether male or female, if you were in your late teens or 20s in the 1980s, you knew Cyndi Lauper. Now, most importantly, she had a number of songs that were huge hits. True Colors was one of them. Time After Time. And of course, her biggest hit was the notable Girls Just Wanna Have Fun, which was something of an anthem, it turned out, at that time. Now, another hit that she had was a remake of a song by the Brains called Money Changes Everything. And that was a pretty big hit for her in 1984. Money Changes Everything. Well, the song may be dated, but the question is still a good one. Does money really change everything? You know, Madonna may have been the material girl, but Cyndi Lauper was asking a question for the ages. Does money change everything? Does it really? Does money change everything? Now, some things, sure, yes. Where we live, where we go to school, the quality of the medical care we receive. Money plays a huge role in all of this. Our relationships, right? Money can be a horrible stressor in a relationship. Striking it rich and going bankrupt can both lead to divorce. Churches are strongly influenced by money. An endowment can be a blessing during hard times. It can also seduce a church into overextending and living beyond its means. But some things money doesn't change. The sun rises in the east and it sets in the west. Doesn't matter how much money we have. Gravity still works, whether we're rich or poor. The area of a circle is equal to pi times the radius squared. Doesn't matter if you're Warren Buffett, the Queen of England, or you and me. Money doesn't change that. Money also doesn't change Jesus' death and resurrection. Jesus' death and resurrection is for all people, regardless of our finances. Jesus' love for us does not change whether we are rich or bankrupt. Another thing that doesn't change is Jesus' attitude towards money and sharing it with God. That's what we see in our scripture lesson today, isn't it? And it's pretty straightforward. Jesus is not pleased with the gifts of the wealthy because they come from what left over. After all the bills have been paid, we've set aside money for winterizing the lake house, the cable upgrade has been paid for, and we have the newest smartphone. What is left over is for God. Well, no, it doesn't work that way. Jesus does not respect that kind of gift. But Jesus does respect the widow's gift. Although what she shares with God is practically nothing, Jesus respects it because it is a sacrifice. It comes from what she has to live on. It makes a difference to the material circumstances of her life. Though it's not much, Jesus respects her gift. As we consider our pledges for 2022, there are a lot of things to bear in mind. The roof on the house. Kids need braces. Medical debt. These are important. These things matter. And what about the saints who came before us, who set the example and so generously paid for all that we enjoy? Are we honoring their sacrifice with our pledge? Another factor to consider is what kind of church we will be. You know, if you remember back to when the mission study team made their report, membership and attendance have dropped by 50% over the last 20 years. And this year, if you read the regular financial statements that come out, in our monthly newsletter, you will see that our giving this year is still below pre-pandemic levels. Now, our section is working on the budget for 2022. But if the pledges aren't there, we may need to cut back on our staffing, our programs, our mission. Yes, there's a lot to consider, no doubt about it. But the most important thing to consider, the most important thing to consider is this. Is our giving more in line with that of the rich or more in line with that of the widow? Is our giving from our excess, our leftovers, our surplus, or is it from what we have to live on? Will it make a difference in our living? Does money change everything? It can change a lot of things, sure. But there are some things money can't change. It can't change Jesus' love for us, and it won't change his attitude about how we share our money with God. Something to think about. May God guide our disciples.
Today we have celebrated a special Sunday. It's a Sunday of All Saints Day, which has a long, long history, tradition in the church in general. It's really that tradition, which even springs from it, Halloween. I mean, you can get your imagination how to get there, I guess. But it is this day where we are called to remember people and saints in our lives who have gone before us. The Catholic Church has their idea of saints, and our Protestant Presbyterian understanding of saints are you and me, friends, the people saved by God, redeemed by God, and even our loved ones who have passed on are saints. And so we call them saints, especially as we remember them and think about them this day. And so we're going to celebrate communion, and then we'll light candles in honor of the members of Westminster who have passed in the last year. And we'll read their names and invite family members, friends to come forward and light candles in their honor. And then we'll also then invite all of you, because we've all lost people, to come forward and light a candle here at this table. And then you can return to your seats. And what we'll do is we'll light up these candles here in the center. We'll take these sticks, light that stick, and then light one of the tea light candles in our loved one, and then place the stick in the sand in the metal jar here. So friends, when we celebrate communion, it's a rich meal with lots of different symbolisms and meanings, but in particular this day, I like to imagine it's like this table that spreads across time, forever in the past, and forever into the future, with Christ at the head, or if Da Vinci got it right, in the middle, somewhere, right? Gathering people from the north, the south, the east, the west, from all time, and every place, to sit together in the kingdom of God. That's the meal itself. Every time we do it, especially this day. Let's pray together. Holy God, it is good thing for us to pause from our lives and give you thanks and praise. For you are the creator and the ruler of the universe. And every good gift we have in our life has come from you. And throughout history, you have enacted in people's lives, calling them by the gift of people, the prophets, rulers, and just friends. Know you more. We give thanks especially in this meal for the gift and the life of Jesus Christ, who most fully showed us who you were. Christ was full of grace and truth, and through his life and death and resurrection showed us your love. We give thanks for the way that his ministry reminds us of the way you heal and restore, forgive, redeem, and even promise us eternal life. Lord, we also give thanks in this meal for the gift of the Spirit, which mysteriously unites us to you and to one another, and even to that great cloud of witnesses loved ones that continue to surround us still and influence us long past their death. Lord, it's in that vein, we give thanks for the ministry of Westminster, especially the people in our community in need of prayer. We think about Keith Smith, who lost his father suddenly this week. We think about beloved member and usher, Marvin Jensen, who passed away suddenly a few days ago. We think about Mike McAllister, who was one of the former band leaders and whose son plays in the band now. We give thanks for his life and pray for them as they laid him to rest yesterday. We also pray for Kay Kugler and her recent priest. Lord, may you take a moment to lift up in our hearts any of those who come to mind who are in need of prayer this day. Holy God, as we prepare to take this meal, be nourished by your very self. May you ask that your very spirit descend then upon these gifts of bread and juice, so that this bread and juice could be your presence to us, so that we in turn could be your presence to the world. We pray all of this in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so it was that it was on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread. And after giving thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, eat of it, all of it. And do this in remembrance of me. This is my body given for you." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, which is sealed in my blood. And it's shed for you all for the forgiveness of sins. Take this, all of you, drink of it, and do this in remembrance of me." And so it is that every time that we eat this bread and we drink this cup, that we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes. Amen. Again, I'm going to now read the names of our members who have passed away. Then we'll invite you to come and light your own candle, and then we'll take communion together. If you haven't got your elements for communion, there are some still in the back table. The first member we lost is Barb Ogden. Barb Smith. Susan Reed. Tim Jensen. Jay Ginther. Lloyd Harp. Robert Schaefer. Justin Coleman. Charles Byer. Jesse McMillan. And now I invite you all, take a moment, and while the music is playing, come forward and light a candle here at the table. Someone who has died in the last year or in years past. Come. Thank you. Holy God, we're grateful, especially this day, for the reminder of the cloud of saints that continues to surround us each and every day. We give thanks especially for the ways in which they show us most fully by their own lives and actions, something a bit about who you are, and taught us how to be better disciples of you. Holy God, we give thanks for the gift of this community that reminds us again of our unity with you, our unity with each other, even our unity with those who are long past. And kindles in us a desire to see those loved ones in the kingdom to come. Lord, as we close this time of communion, as we always do, we say this prayer together that you taught us to pray. Say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory of your earth. Again, I invite you to rise in body or spirit.
And may the Holy Lord God lift his countenance to you